Right, Aki Kareem, BBTV. Got a very special one for you today. It's a bit of a trip down memory lane. I've got Warren Tansey with me, aka Rocky, from in the day.
Oh, yeah, bloody hell.
And we're going to talk a little bit about your story, journey in boxing, and what you're doing now. So, mate, just take us back from the beginning, because you was a really good amateur boxer, weren't you?
Yeah, I was quite good as an amateur. Started boxing when I was 6 years old at Borshaw. Yeah, I was quite an elite amateur, really. Won a national title as a junior. Got picked to box for England a few times. Went over to Canada, boxing Ireland. Done all right as an amateur. I think I had 50 fights as an amateur. Yeah, it was quite a good career, really. But sort of ended pretty bad, so... I had a good amateur career. Yeah.
Yeah, we're going to get to your sort of your journey in and out of boxing, but you sort of were associated with Borshaw Boxing Club, weren't you? Which is not very far away from here.
Yeah, I've always been from Borshaw since I was 6 years old. That's where I started from, and that's where I've always been from. Yeah, it's like my second home when I was boxing, Borshaw, yeah.
What actually got you into boxing? Was it just was it family thing? Was it just the area you grew up in? What was it?
No, it was my granddad. My granddad took me boxing 3 times a week, every single week. He wouldn't let me not go. I think I was a little bit soft as a kid, I was a bit mad, so my granddad stepped in and then just kept pursuing me to go. He was the proudest man ever, and he was just relentless to making me succeed in boxing. So that's why I started, really, through my granddad. Mm. Yeah, and basically I kept it going because I didn't want to let him down, because I knew how much effort he'd put into me and to succeed at it. So yeah, it was down to my granddad, really. Mm.
But I suppose there's one thing going to the boxing club. We've all been to the boxing club, but then there's a different thing competing and getting in the ring and keeping it up and then getting smashed in the face the first time and everything like that. But you must have loved it as well somewhere deep down.
Yeah, I think I found a love for it. You know, I had a good group of friends at Borshaw, and it was great. I just love everything about it. It made me feel good. It teaches you a lot about discipline, respect, and you're just a good person from it, really, and it is hard. It does test you, but it's quite good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You loved it enough to turn over. You turned over, and that's something to decide you want to do it for a living, for a career. Mm. What sort of inspired that decision for you to actually want to turn over with Borshaw?
Well, I was a bit late turning over. I was 27 years of age when I turned over. So I was really, I found, after I left being an amateur, I had a few problems out of school and stuff and through my midlife and basically how everyone does, but I suffered quite a heavy stabbing through my chest. I had a punctured lung at the end of my amateur career. That's what made me retire from being an amateur, so... I was nearly dead, to be honest. I suffered and blade right through my chest into my lung, so I had to stop boxing altogether. Then I went off the rails, sort of lost my head a little bit. Then I come back into it late, so maybe, I don't know, it's always been in me to be a boxer, so maybe it just found me again and then sort of went back to it. But yeah,
that's a bit of an intense period of your life, though, really.
Yeah, it was.
That sounds intense. What at that stage you're probably thinking, oh, I'll never. You might even think, oh, I'll never even do normal things again, let alone box again.
Yeah, I was literally nearly dead. I was drowning in my own blood, and I was in a bad place. But I seemed to recovered from it and found boxing again. Well, it found me. It was just always something that I had in me to do. So maybe it was a bit late to turn pro, but I still had a good go at it. And then the story begins from being a professional then, really.
Mm. Mm. Tell us about that story then, because when you've turned over, you've had this, you've recovered from this miraculous recovery and everything, yeah. But are you then going into boxing fearless because you've had something there which should have killed you?
Yeah, I suppose, but I was never, when you're fully healed, you forget about the pain you've been in. You don't really remember it, so you just carry on. But I don't think I ever felt like it had affected me ever again. I just thought this is my next step now to move forward with my professional career, and just let's see how far we can go. You know, let's see what I can do.
You turn over and they put you in with a giant southpaw on your pro debut, which is your only loss on your record.
Yeah.
What are you thinking now when they put you in there with this big giant southpaw?
Well, yeah, so my first fight was, obviously it was, I was very nervous about boxing, professional, but I didn't really get stitched up, to be honest, but I got put in with a 6'4" southpaw and sort of a change of opponent. But, you know, I lost the fight, but maybe I didn't lose the fight, like lost it a lot. It could have gone anyway. It was just maybe I did lose it, maybe I didn't. It was that kind of fight, but I lost it on more of me being too nervous. The occasion got to me. But, yeah, so that it was a bit of a sticky one, really. It was a bit of a hard pill to swallow for my first professional fight anyway.
Some fighters go on the road after they've lost the first fight. Some fighters decide they're going to be an away corner fighter, they're going to do that. You didn't. You decided get back in there and crack on with it.
Well, yeah, I thought, well, it makes or breaks you, doesn't it? So I thought, well, I got in, got straight back in, said to Steve Woods, get me back in there, Steve, I need to right the wrongs here. So, yeah, I come back with 3 knockouts on the bounce then, and I was flying. Yeah, and just carried on from there, really, yeah.
Oh, so Steve Wood was your manager, was he, yeah?
Yeah, Steve Woods, yeah. Yeah,
does a lot for the North West lads. What was he like back then when, as a manager?
Steve was great, and couldn't have said anything bad about him, really. In looking back on it, I'm glad that he gave me that fight, that I got put in with a really awkward opponent for my first one, because then it made me realise how hard I need to train to be better, to overcome other opponents. So it's a blessing in disguise, really. When I look back now, a loss is as good as a win if you use it that in the right way. Do you know what I mean? So yeah.
Well, when I first met you was over at the Finest Gym. You'd retired by then, but I know you had some fights over there, didn't you, with Steve Mailer?
No,
or did never. You never any pro fights there, right?
No, but I went over there with Liam Taylor, because Liam decided to. I've been with Liam since day one as a professional, so me and Liam had stuck together, and we went over to the Finest, and I sort of trained there, and Liam turned pro with Steve, so that's the connection why I'm over at Steve's gym.
Right. Okay, that clears that up. Going back to your own career, you say you come off the three stoppages. I've got your record here, by the way. So, yeah, I mean, you had a really good stretch of form, didn't you? You didn't have that breakout fight, but I suppose you were on the verge of that breakout fight, weren't you, in 2016 when you had to leave the sport? But you started to notice injuries creeping in, didn't you?
Yeah. I suffered a rotator cuff repair, a rotator cuff injury, and my shoulder had actually broke. My shoulder was broken through boxing, so I had 2 surgeries on my shoulder. I had a rotator cuff repair, the piece of bone put back, and then it still kept causing me a lot of pain. So then I had to go back and have another operation on my shoulder. I had to have all my ligaments anchored to my joint at the top. So they was the first 2 injuries that I suffered through my boxing career, which basically should have really written my career off anyway, because it's quite serious injuries. But I got through them okay, and then suffered, as most boxers do, a hand injury. I had all my ligaments done, so that's 3 injuries that I suffered, and then we moved forward to getting sort of got nerve damage to me brain, which caused my eyes to get which caused me to have what you call diplopia, which is double vision. So yeah, I suffered that as well through my boxing career.
Well, that's a multitude of different injuries there. I mean, how many fights were you fighting with these various injuries?
Basically, nearly all of them, really. From about my fifth fight onwards, I remember getting it off a Polish lad on the top of my head, and he stunned me a little bit, and then I thought he had a concussion, and I thought, oh, it'll just go away, and it never went away, and that's where I suffered the double vision from. But I just sort of hid the fact that I had double vision and just still carried on with boxing, but really I shouldn't have been in the ring, really. Because I wanted to succeed so much, I kept just going through my injuries, through the vision and stuff. But yeah, it's a sticky one, really.
What is it that made you knew you shouldn't be in the ring? Probably people around you were saying, Warren, you shouldn't be in the ring.
Yeah.
You know, but you kept getting back in the ring. So what was it? I mean, what is it? Is it the determination? Was it your old granddad, as you were saying there, or what was it that kept you getting back in the ring?
It was more, I just wanted to achieve something. I wanted to leave the sport with some sort of belt or some sort of memory or an achievement that I had something, because I'd boxed for 27 years in and out the ring as an amateur and a pro, so I felt like I deserved something from the game. But it didn't work out that way, so that was just the way it was, you know.
Yeah, I mean, in the end, you so it was 2016 that you retired. Well, yeah. You never officially come out and said I've retired, but that was your last fight. After that last fight, I believe that one was a draw, I think, the last one.
Yeah.
At that stage, well, what was the thing that sort of made you decide you had to walk away from the game?
Well, I thought, well, if I couldn't train, I couldn't spar because I was worried that I'd make my vision worse. So I had to go into these fights with no sparring, and I couldn't prepare myself properly to be able to exceed, even to get an English title or something along them lines, or an area title, which I was definitely capable of doing. So I just had a word with myself, and I thought, drawing the last fight, I thought, well, you call it a draw now, as they would say, you know, it's time to sort of move on to something else. And yeah, it was heartbreaking, but it's just something I had to do for me and my family, because I knew that if I carried on, I would be in a serious mess. Like, I would be in a bad place with me. It was not getting any better, me vision anyway, and getting punched in the head obviously making it worse.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's
I think I interview so many fighters, retired ones, who in particularly say that, you know, even ones that were world champions, and they say when they first retire, it's so difficult. But you know, you've gone through this journey, and you've not got to anywhere near where you need to or wanted to get in your own heart. So how did you take the first few sort of months, initial phase of that?
Basically, I love boxing. I love it because it's part of my life. So I basically, by sticking with Liam and being in part of Steve Maylock's gym, with Liam and Terry and Jack and Zach and all them, sort of gave me a little bit of something back out of the game that I'd give so much to. So seeing Liam achieve stuff and being around people like Terry and Jack Raff and Zach Miller, it made me feel a bit more fulfilled with what I was getting out, what I wanted out of the game. So I sort of, like, Liam, obviously, is one of my best friends. He sort of helps me in a way that he doesn't really understand, by me going to the gym with him every week and training with him and still being part of the team but not being having to box. So yeah, that was sort of what did help me get through a bit of sort of depression and anxiety through not being able to do it myself. Yeah.
Yeah, you said you went through some, you know, dark times, and I think it's important to talk about this sort of issue because a lot, it does affect a lot of people, and So they don't want to come forward, I suppose.
Yeah.
But what was those days actually like for you? Like, what was it like?
It's just the points where you just think, what else have I got left? Because this is everything that I've ever wanted in my life. What am I going to do now? Where else am I going to go? How am I going to show my kids how to achieve stuff if I can't achieve it? How am I going to be a role model for them? You know, there's loads of questions that go through your head, and I mean, a lot of boxers will tell you, when your boxing career is over, through no fault of your own, then it's a bitter pill to swallow, because when you put your heart and soul into it, and there's nothing else left, then you feel like you're worthless, like you've got nothing, and you know, part of your time, you don't want to be here, you know. And I would never do that, but you know, you do have thoughts, and I think everyone would have them thoughts. But I suppose your kids inspire you to be better and how to overcome things. So yeah, it's sticky one.
So you know, you've gone to the gym. You've got this role where you can help young lads coming through. You know, that's helping you a bit. You're also, there's this empty sort of vacuum, but you filled it with doing other things. So you actually, I filled it with doing loads of other things. So tell us a little bit about the stuff that you took up after, when you realised you couldn't continue being a pro boxer.
Well, I've just thought, because I'm so ambitious with things, and like, obviously I'm an achiever, and I want to show my kids that you can achieve anything, whatever state you're in, or mental state or physical. So I decided to start the Ironman, so I did three Ironman. I've done three Ironman now, which is very difficult to do. Done about eight marathons, God knows.
Just explain what an Ironman is for people who don't really know when they're watching this. Just explain the extent of how hard it is.
Yeah, so an Ironman is a 2.4 mile swim, 112 mile bike ride, and a marathon, just straight off, like one after the other. So yeah, I did two in Lanzarote, which is one of the hardest to do in the world, and then I did one in Bolton, and then I've done a half Ironman as well in between them as training. So
but that's like the most extreme thing you could do. So like, sounds like you just needed that to show, like, look, listen, you know what, I can do something which other people can't do, which is like what boxing is basically.
Of course, yeah. I mean, with the injuries that I've had, i.e. my vision and stuff like that, I just thought, well, what else can I do to feel some fulfillment with, because it's very difficult to find that good feeling, because when you're boxing, it's that winning feeling. There's nothing better, do you know what I mean? It's a good feeling. So I sort of found it with the Ironman and stuff. Maybe not as good as winning boxing, but I sort of found it with the Ironman. And
You got something else coming up though, which when you first told me about it a few weeks ago, sounded like a proper epic adventure as well, swimming the Channel.
Yeah.
Now, I've seen old documentaries of people swimming the Channel, you know, with goose fat all over them.
Yeah.
Is it still like that?
Yeah, so in the pandemic, I've been suffering from my shoulder injury because of all the surgery I've had. So I've got to go and see a surgeon, and basically I need a full shoulder replacement now because I've got stage 4 arthritis in it. So that got me another, and I was just felt really down, and I thought, you know what, I'm going to do something to defy the odds here. The doctor told me that I wouldn't be able to swim a mile with the injury, because I told him I would like to swim the English Channel, and he more or less laughed at me. So that just inspired me then to go away and start training for the English Channel. So where I'm at now is I'm swimming the English Channel in 3 weeks. So the English Channel is like, it's be like 26 mile swim in just no wetsuit, no nothing, in just like your speedos and basically goose fat all over your body. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, so yeah,
sounds a bit kinky, that, you know, speedos.
Well, it would be kinky if you rubbed it on me, wouldn't it, to be honest. What, yeah.
I see what I'm doing on that day, mate. Whatever it is, I will make sure I get out of it and come and see you.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, it's got to go everywhere, though. You know that, don't you?
That's fine. I'm up for it.
The chafing.
But again, that's another one, though, isn't it? That's another one where it's like you're almost replacing that challenge with presenting yourself with these big obstacles.
Yeah, I like, as I've had a chat with you, I mean, I feel like there's a lot of people like me who have suffered from injuries and been able to retire from something like boxing and feel like they've got nothing left or they've got nothing else to do, because that's where I was. And it's very difficult to find fulfillment with something else. So I feel like if I can do stuff like this and find fulfillment in other things, then maybe it'll inspire other people to do stuff. Because you hear a lot of boxers that do go a lot depressed, and they do find the drink, and they go down the wrong road. And you know, I suppose it's good for me to show that I can do stuff so other people can do it, you know, and achieve stuff apart from boxing, you know.
And your role in the gym now, though, as well, that is something. What's your actual role in the gym? And is it just the fact that, you know, I'm talking about the finest gym now.
Yeah.
Is it just being around the lads, as you mentioned there, or is it?
Yeah, well, I train a lot with the lads, so I can push them on the things like the bike and swimming, because that's what I do in the Ironman. And I help Steve out a lot now in the corners, because I've been with Liam since day one, so me and Liam have been part of Liam's team from since he started. So Steve and all the lads in that gym have been great. I feel I'm part of the team in there. I help out. We do the corners. We just do everything. We train together. We have a laugh. It's great because I can push them on things, and it's sort of that the finest as well has sort of helped me sort of feel better about boxing, because I feel part of a team. You know, there's something else for me to be involved with, you know, as well, because I have retired from boxing. I can still train with the lads and be around boxing, what I love, you know, and it's nice. It's good. I enjoy it.
Mm. And of course, though, you know, you've got two young lads.
Yeah, yeah.
Reggie and Ace, who are always doing something on Instagram, like they're doing like push-ups, pull-ups, they're swinging on them ropes, which are there. They're doing all sorts.
Yeah.
Is that something for you? I mean, that make you extra proud because you can see like traits in them, which.
Yeah, you know. I mean, like the way I've come through my life, I suppose. You learn. If I'd have known what I know now, then I wouldn't have gone through the injuries that I did when I was boxing. So it's up for me now. It's up to me now to teach my kids how to develop better than I did, and I believe that they will, and I believe that they're already if anyone knows them, they're like quite supreme athletes already. They're very advanced. So yeah, I mean, it makes me proud that I've been through what I've been through, so I can pass it on to others, and especially my kids anyway, you know. I'm not trying to say that I'm this big I am, because I'm not, but, you know, I feel like if I can help people overcome injuries and still find fulfillment with something else, or I can pass stuff on to my kids, then I think I'm pretty proud that I can do that, you know. Do you know what I mean? I care.
Yeah.
I really am.
There's people in the boxing industry watching this now who might be currently in that down phase or currently feeling a bit low and whatever. Your advice to them?
Yeah, I've been there. Honestly, I've been there. And, you know, no matter what level I got to in boxing, you know, it doesn't matter. I was still a good professional athlete, and I still couldn't. But yeah, the advice I could give somebody, you know, if somebody is struggling from injuries like I have, there's always something else you can do to adapt and overcome stuff, i.e. vision or shoulder or any sort of injury. There's always fulfillment in something else, because a lot of boxers are very ambitious. They want to succeed in life by activities such as training. So, you know, a sort of my story will sort of might inspire people to get out of that dungeon that they're in and go, you know what, well, if Warren can go and do 3 Ironmen and whatever, so many bloody marathons and triathlons and attempt to swim the English Channel, then maybe I could do something. Do you know what I mean? So I mean, Aka.
So yeah, definitely.
You know, yeah.
And this particular one's for charity, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I do all the Ironmen that I do. I've always done it for cystic fibrosis. I've raised over £10,000 now. So, because cystic fibrosis is like, it's a lung disease what people suffer from, and it's a nasty disease. It's not good, and three of my one of my best friend's children, three of the girls have got cystic fibrosis, and they're like my godchildren. So I do everything for that charity, and I will be swimming the English Channel in 3 weeks for that charity. So if anyone, I'm going to put it on my Instagram, so if anyone wants to donate, it'd be more than thankful. Do you know
what I
mean?
Is this a Just Giving page, yeah?
Yeah, Just Giving page.
Right, the link, people, the link is going to be on the description underneath this YouTube video. So if you want to donate, get on that link underneath now, please.
Yes, yeah. that'd be great, that, mate. It'd be magic, that.
Well, it's a massive challenge, to be fair. Like, I don't even like driving 26 miles.
Yeah.
Let alone swimming it. It's a big challenge.
Yeah, it's massive. It scares me, to be honest. Like, I've been training in Scotland in the sea. I'm scared of the sea. Scared of jellyfish. But I don't know, it's a challenge that I think I can do, but it's going to be really difficult. It's the cold. It's swimming for, 15 hours in the cold that might really, I don't know. We'll see how far I can get, do you know what I mean?
When you swim the channel, do you have, like, obviously a safety crew that goes with you?
Yeah, I've got a boat at the side of me, what's all booked and ready, so I've got a boat that's just shows me the route that goes across the crossings, because it's quite a busy crossing that for all the ships and stuff. But yeah, so basically I've got the boat at the side of me, and then I've just got to keep swimming. I'm not allowed to touch the boat, I'm not allowed to touch anybody. I've got to get feeds through off the boat to me on rope, so I can get me nutrients down me, and then I've just got to swim for like 15 hours, and that's what time it should take me with my swimming pace. So hopefully I'll get a good day where the current's good and it'll help me, but I could get a bad day where it's against me and I might struggle, but I'm sure I'll try my best to get over, do you know what I mean?
You must have been at that point in particularly in the Ironmans, or even in training for this, where you get to that point where it's like, oh, I'm not sure I can carry on.
Yeah, I mean, in the second Lanzarote Ironman, I swallowed a lot of seawater, so I couldn't eat anything on the way around because I was really sick. So I'd done the swim, the bike, and the half the marathon, and my body just shut off completely. And I don't know how I got through the rest of it. So obviously I completed it in a decent time anyway, but I suppose that's another lesson that I've learned, that I can go through things that are very difficult, because my body just shut down. I was looking at my legs, trying to grab my legs, putting one in front of the other. My mind was there, but my body just shut off. So when people talk about hitting the wall, that's what I hit. Do you know what I mean? I hit the wall, and it was a mad feeling, but yeah, it was, hopefully I won't hit that in the channel, but I've no doubt that will, because this is a massive challenge. But we'll see.
Well, I wish you the best of luck with it, because it's, let us know how you get on with that. You know, when you look at the boxing industry now, then, when you look at the actual boxing industry, do you look back at it in, how do you view the sport of boxing now then?
I don't know. I look at it like, it's a hard game. It's a very, very difficult game. I suppose I look at it like it's quite bad in some senses because of everything that I've been through, but yet I see some of the enjoyment that it brings to the likes of Liam and Terry and Jack and Zach, and I think, you know what, it is good. It helps people, because if these lads, what I've just spoke about, never had boxing, then God knows where they'd be in life. You know, because there's only a certain breed that can do it, and without boxing, then they would be this breed that would be on the streets, bloody causing trouble and in jail. And so there's a lot of benefits from it without really understanding. It's not just fighting, it's the characters that come into boxing need boxing to save them from other things that they would go down, you know, and I do generally believe that. So, yeah 100%.
100%. Because people who in boxing have got that mentality, it's like kill or be killed mentality.
Yeah.
Which is dangerous on the street, really, isn't it?
Yeah, but then if you look at people who've retired, they go that way because they can't fulfil themselves with other things. So that's where I think I found a good path with the Ironman and the channel and being part of the Finest Gym. But other people hasn't got that, or they've not been able to do that. So, do you know what I mean? Don't you, Aki? You know where I'm coming from with that?
Yeah, it's definitely.
People that retire, they normally just go on the beer, on the piss, and they're in trouble and they're fighting, and it's mad. It's crazy. It is a crazy sport. Mad.
You've had some crazy good nights, though, with the likes of Terry, you know, world champ. I think he was 33-0 at one point.
Yeah.
And, you know, you had some trips out to America as well.
Yeah, to New Orleans.
New Orleans.
Been over there. Been to Ireland with him. It's been great with the Finest since Liam went over there. I've had such a good time with him. And it's been a great team to be around. Really nice people and achievers. People that want to achieve, and that's the type of people I want to be around. Yeah, so as well as when I retired from boxing, I went and got me amateur coaching badge, which is so I decided, obviously, that I wanted to give back a bit because I knew so much about boxing, and went and started coaching at the shed, Ben Lancaster's there. So I had 2 years with the amateurs there. And obviously with the COVID and everything else, the gym shut down and the amateurs, it's just gone to nothing now, really. So that was, so that's what another thing that I've done.
Oops, good catch, you still got the reaction speed.
You know what
there,
I mean? The vision's getting better now, isn't it? So that's another thing I've done as well. So I've sort of tried to give back with my amateur. Well, maybe it'll come back and I'll maybe be able to go back and do it again, do you know what I mean? When it all settles down, this COVID. But yeah.
You got some good younger kids coming through as well at the gym. Zach Miller's one.
Oh yeah,
he's a character.
Oh, he's a character. Yeah. he's always naked in the gym. Man.
I've seen the pictures. Yeah. He's always showing the pictures.
Jack.
Yeah.
They're just great lads, and they're all ambitious. And you've got Steve as the coach there, who's just fantastic. You've never seen a coach who's given as much effort to people as Steve does. He's just bang on with everything. Like, they all get on dead well. It's like a family down there. It's just great to be around it all. It's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant.
I've enjoyed this chat, you know. I've enjoyed finding out a bit more about this story.
Yeah.
There's I know you wanted to get things off your chest. Do you feel like you've got the stuff that you wanted to, the message across that you wanted to get across?
Yeah, I feel like I've never really announced a retirement from boxing and the reasons why. So it's nice to sort of get it out there and maybe I could look back on this in a few years and go, yeah, that was good, you know. But as well as it might inspire other people, like I said before, to look at this and go, well, look what he's done after boxing. Maybe I could do that. Maybe it could change other people's lives to be a better person from boxing than just going on the pit on the piss and going in jail and just being the wrong person. Do you know what I mean? So yeah.
And that's a good positive message to end on, really. But watch out for Reggie and Ace as well, because there could be two world champions there. You know, you never know. You're gonna get him into boxing?
I don't know. I don't know. I feel like I'm going to let them do whatever they want to do, but I feel like they will definitely exceed at something. because they're good, aren't they?
Yeah, yeah.
They're quite special, like.
They surprise me sometimes when I watch the videos. I'm surprised that they can do that.
I know, it's mad. It's mad.
Especially it's the crazy. Body, especially the like the body stuff. What you call it, calisthenics, you call it, or something like that. Where you use your own body weight.
Yeah, they're just on the Olympic rings all the time. They're good kids. They're really good, and they just. I thought, oh yeah, they're good. I just put all my time and effort into them now as well, and want them to develop good. But yeah, they're just mad. They're hard work though. I'll tell you what, they're hard. Aren't they, Dan? They're hard, aren't they? Mental. Yeah. Mental.
Well, I've got two girls. That's hard enough. That's hard enough. It's just having one or two kids is just hard in general, isn't it?
Yeah, but they've got that much energy. Okay, they just people will see them on my Instagram. They just all over the show doing everything. They're just swimmers. They're acrobats. They're wrestlers. They're cage fighters. They're boxers. They're everything.
Right, Warren, you're gonna show us a few of your achievements in boxing.
Yeah, sound, yeah.
And then we're going to look at some of the Ironman stuff.
So, obviously, that's the British Masters belt that I won. That was a 10-round fight. So I won that. That's the only thing, really. I got out of being a professional.
Terry rips you for that one, does he?
He tries, doesn't he? But, well, he can do, can't he? Because he's got a WBO belt, so...
Yeah.
But I'd still beat him up anyway. So these are me... Ironman belts, medals. So that's an half Ironman, one half Ironman, a Lanzarote Ironman, another Lanzarote Ironman, a Bolton Ironman, a marathon, another marathon, an Edinburgh marathon, a Salford triathlon, a half marathon. Another marathon. I don't know. They just go
there, isn't there?
Yeah. So like, they're the things I've achieved sort of after boxing.
And out of all of them, the hardest one, the Lanzarote Ironman, did you say?
Yeah, number two. Yeah, I think it was that one. That's the one where I suffered when I hit the wall. Definitely hit the wall on that, and I just couldn't move, but still got through it. So that was the hardest one. To be honest, yeah. So
and I noticed as well in the garden, you got it all set up for like it's like a blooming obstacle course out there, isn't it? You got all sports and stuff.
Yeah,
there,
just got all like for the kids and that. Yeah. It's got like an outdoor gym. All the kids just climb on there. They just do all sorts of stuff on it. I've got like swings and ropes that hook on there, but I took them off now. So. Yeah,
but you got it all set out, haven't you?
Yeah, it's good, yeah.
Basically, it all action. It's basically,
the pull-up bar, the kids' pull-up bar in the garden.
Yeah, go on, you were telling me, was it Reggie was broke some record or something, or...?
No.
We think it might be a record.
Our Ace done...
He'd
done 150 pull-ups before school, a couple of weeks ago now. So, yeah, when he was four, because he's just turned five. When he was four, he'd done 150 pull-ups he'd done before school. So, they do like 50 pull-ups for school every morning. So, yeah, they just
that's
mad.
Insane, that.
Yeah, they're good. Yeah. So, yeah. Just do everything. Four-year-old done 150 pull-ups before school last week.
Mad, that.
I was like, 20 pull-ups. Dad, I got to 150 and I thought, bloody hell, it was only four, do you know what I mean?
There might be a Guinness Book of Records in there, you know. We'll have to check.
Yeah, I think there might be, yeah.
If there is, let me come and film it. I want the exclusive.
100%, yeah. Mad.
No, that's good, mate. And it's like the next generation, isn't it? So all the things that you couldn't do for the injury reasons and everything, whatever it is, you've got two young lads there who you can enjoy growing up, and that in itself gives you a different motivation as well, doesn't it?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, yeah. It's. I think you just learn through life. You learn what's happened to you, and you can pass it on to other people. And that's what it's all about, isn't it? You know, making them grow to be better. Especially, they're our future now, our kids. So it's good to give back to them and watch them develop. You know, where I failed, they might succeed. You know what I mean? So yeah, it's good.
One final message, Warren, from you to the boxing community. Just one final message from you to them.
I don't know. Don't give up. That's what I tell everyone. That's what I tell my kids. Don't give up on anything in life. If boxing's over, or if you're still boxing, just don't give up.
Don't give up. Perfect way to end. Yeah. It's a great message. I've enjoyed that, mate. And
nice one, pal. Thanks.
Catch up again soon.
Yeah, cool.